Jerry, who I laid out tonight. And he laid down out in no man's land. He was there for about 10 minutes, about 20 yards out. And I went and dragged him in, it was a Jerry. I dragged him in, I laid him on the fire step, and he was all blue in the face. And I said to him, he's nothing, Timmy. I said to him, before he passed out, I said, you bloody fool. If he'd have, you know, gave himself up, and I'd have taken him prison. But he turned to run back, and I challenged him, and that because I shot him in the back of the head. And I never forgot that fella. He was only a young fella, and he was only about 15 or 16, and he got a brand new uniform on, and he must have got lost coming from his own lines into our lines, and just straight. And I felt sorry for that. He was only a kiddie, and I'm sorry I did shoot him. Matter of fact,
how many people do you think that you did kill during the war?
Oh, good Lord, I couldn't say. I was in the Lewis Gunners. You know, I've got the memories and that.
Mr. Williams, was it all worth it?
No. I can never have me going if I was, you know, old enough, younger. Never get me again to volunteer, not me. Never.
Why do you say that?
I've seen all this, what's name, you know, and what I've been through and that, and I'll never volunteer for anything else.
One day we got orders to storm a French position. We got in, and my comrades fell right and left of me, but then I was confronted by a French corporal, he with his bayonet at the ready, and I with my bayonet at the ready. For a moment, I felt the fear of death. And in a fraction of a second, I realized that he was after my life exactly as I was after his. I was quicker than he. I tossed his rifle away, and I ran my bayonet through his chest. He fell, put his hand on the place where I had hit him, and then I thrust again. Blood came out of his mouth, and he died. I felt physically ill. I nearly vomited. My knees were shaking, and I was, quite frankly, ashamed of myself. My comrades, I was a corporal there then, were absolutely undisturbed by what had happened. One of them boasted that he had killed the poor Lee with the butt of his rifle. Another one had strangled the captain, French captain. A third one had hit somebody over the head with his spade. They were ordinary men like me. One of them was a tram conductor. Another one a commercial traveler, two were students, the rest were farm workers, ordinary people who never would have thought to do any harm to anyone. How did it come about that they were so cruel? I remembered then that they were told that the good soldier kills without thinking of his adversary as a human being. The very moment he sees in him a fellow man, he is not a good soldier. But I had in front of me the dead man, dead French soldier. And how would I like him to have raised his hand? I would have shaken his hand, and he would have been the best friend, because he was nothing like me, but a poor boy who had to fight, who had to go in with the most cruel weapons against the men who had nothing against them personally, who only wore the uniform of another nation, who spoke another language, but the men who had father and mother, and a family perhaps. And so I felt. I woke up at night sometimes drenched in sweat because I saw the eyes of my fallen adversary, the enemy, and I tried to convince myself what would have happened to me if I wouldn't have been quicker than him, what would have happened to me if I wouldn't have thrust my bayonet first into his head. What was it that these soldiers stabbed each other, strangled each other, went for each other like mad dogs? What was it that we, who had nothing against them personally, fought with them to the very end of death? To fire at each other from a distance, to drop bombs is something impersonal. But to see each other's white in the eyes and then to run with a bayonet against a man, that was against my conception and against my inner feeling.